Hello? 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 Hello?
In the just last few minutes, you might notice it's a little cooler in the sanctuary today. It's our way.
Test. Yeah, the sound. Test one more time. Test. You can see the sound is coming through. Yeah.
Peace of Christ be with you. Welcome to all who have gathered with us. Greetings to those visiting with us and to those joining us through the wonder of live streaming. We're going to have some music in a moment just to go over, but I'll start in on a couple of announcements here, and Tammy has a special update to share with us.
Just a quick announcement that a couple weeks ago we met as a joint worship, both the 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock, about the core purpose of church. We had some wonderful conversations, and many of those comments that you have are written down. They will be available in the fellowship hall after worship. They also are available in hard copy where the bulletins are on each side. If you would like an electronic copy to save a tree, send a note to the church and we'll make sure you get a copy. Thanks.
Thank you, Tammy. And Kelly, we have some music we're going to look at as we prepare for worship.
We do. The first one is More Voices 127, which is very appropriate for the message today. It's about the widow and her two pennies. I saw the rich ones. Have a listen to see what it sounds like. The choir will help you too. Sing that much, and we'll do the chorus in a minute.
I saw the rich ones.
On the offbeat clapping.
Do we?
Yes,
okay,
we do.
Shall we do that?
We have to work at this.
One, two.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Okay, here we go. One more verse and we'll try it, okay? Same, we'll sing the same verse. Got the last one is, what have I missed? 1591. Ah, this is good. It's a dedication. What can I give? What can I give? What can I do? Pardon me. Here's what it sounds like.
This coming Saturday.
Yes, just to alert you to your bulletin, next Saturday we have, we're co-sponsoring a workshop called The Song of Miriam, The Dance of the Sacred Feminine, and it's in the chapel. You need to bring your own lunch. You should register by phoning the church office. It does cost $75, but I do have some funding. If that doesn't meet your budget, just let me know. And I think it will be a wonderful day. So please think about it. Thanks.
And Megami, that's on Saturday. And then Sunday evening next week, Megami has an announcement to share with us too.
No, what's going to happen? Sunday night turkey dinner. This might be one of the last turkey dinners we can have at Fellowship Hall. So not only you, but invite your friends and families, and we're going to sing. This is Advent turkey dinner. So we're going to sing all the Christmas carols and also your favorite 12 days of Christmas too. So hope you can make it, and the tickets are sold after the service. Thank you.
Thank you, and our thanks to Al Fowler and to Kelly and Tammy and others who looked after service last Sunday. For several years now, there's been a custom for Megami and myself to get a little holiday break at the beginning of November. We miss one Sunday usually, so we're away for 12 days. Now, many of you won't know this, but when Megami was a young girl, 6, 7 years old, she was ill for quite a while, not going to school, but she was an avid reader and she read all sorts of books while she was at home convalescing. And at that time, she read a book about someone named Mozart. And ever since, she had this dream. She would love to go and see Mozart's hometown of Salzburg and Vienna, where he lived the last years. And anyway, what happened is last spring, we said, well, let's do that this November. And a lot has happened in our world since then. But I have a practice of never taking out insurance on the flights I book. So we said, well, I guess we're going. So we went. And we saw many things. We only saw a few things that reminded us of what that part of Europe is going through around the refugee crisis. For instance, as we took train from Salzburg to Munich, there were 30 refugees on our train, and things were being handled in a very respectful, very caring way, we thought, from what we could see there. And you will know that Germany has surprised everyone with the great generosity of spirit, and yet other European countries have not been as quick to respond, Austria being one such country. When we were in Vienna, we went to a little cafe. Rick Steves said you should go there, so we went. And as we sat down, the young waiter came up to us, and here he had this T-shirt in bold writing, "A Heart for Refugees." I thought, wow, that was a courageous, daring thing for you to do in Austria, to wear that right there in Vienna. And then after he took our order, he walked away, and I wondered how the management allowed him to get away with it. But as he walked away, on his back was the name of the cafe. And we looked around and we saw all of the employees had the same T-shirt on. And I thought, maybe we should order those sorts of T-shirts for First Met, A Heart for Refugees. It was a reminder that whatever situation we're in, whatever context, there are ways that we can advocate and work for a better world today. So next week, there is someone who will be with us who knows much more of the inside story of what is happening in Germany and elsewhere in Europe on the refugee situation. We're so honored that Alison Paul will be with us, and she's recently back from Germany. We actually met with Alison and Lisa Ann, who are mentioned in the announcement here. Well, Lisa Ann now is off to Ottawa, involved in the coordination of the applications processing of refugees to Canada. So she won't be with us, but Alison Paul will be, and it's a golden opportunity for us. Let your neighbors know. They're welcome to come and join us in worship. She'll be at both the 9 o'clock and the 11 o'clock service. So it's a great opportunity, and there'll be some Q&A time as an option for people afterwards as well. So we hope that you'll mark next week as a special red letter day in the life of our church. Today, in our service, we remember especially our ongoing ministry of Out of the Rain Youth Shelter, and there'll be more about that with Janet Gray in our service today. I'm going to ask David now if he would come forward and light the Christ candle. Sunday by Sunday, we remember that Christ indeed is in our midst, and that he invites us also to let our light shine. We also at this time light another candle. There have been many events in this past week. Today, as we light the candle, we remember the people of Paris. We remember those who have suffered through the tragic loss and injury, not only in Paris, but also in regions of the Middle East and other parts of this world. We pray for peace throughout the world. We pray for peace this day. Let us join together in the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, our Mother, who art in heaven, one of our youth now leads us in the invitation to worship.
With God as the architect, our structures will be sound.
With the Holy One,
Let every generation place their trust in the Creator. The poor will receive good news. Each person and creature will feel secure and at home.
Let us dance with the Spirit.
Something from here. Let's see.
God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good. Oh, wow. Yeah, I am. Okay. I have here something. I wondered how many of you have bicycles or tricycles? All of you? Yeah, good, good. And I just want you to see here, spoke. Here's a spoke here, right? And here's a hub here. And I just wanted to think about this center here, hub, is love and God. So the spoke, if you're far away, it's so different, open, big way here. Separated, but it's closer, closer, but narrow, narrow. So when you love, you're close to God, and also close to everybody here, each other, too. Think about those, each one of you. So whenever you are doing riding, bicycle, tricycle, think about center, it's God, and love, and you're closer and closer to God, you're closer to friends too. And if you're far away, you have to work harder. But closer, you can work together. And I have something other things too. Maybe somebody can just hold this one? Good. Apple, you know those? Same too. Look here. See? Here, God's love, God here, and here, everybody's here. And everybody's closer to God, and everybody much closer, each other, too. So you remember when you eat apples, same thing, and closer to God. And all of you helping each other together. And for example, I saw you saw what happened in Paris. It's so sad. But did you see so many people get together and lighting candles and helping each other to say we want to have a peaceful world? So we're going to go to Sunday school. And next Sunday, we're going to have a Children's Sunday too. So we're going to have balloons and parachute too, so hope you can help us. So we're going to go Sunday school, and if anybody likes to have this bicycle, it's for anybody likes to need it and available for you. All right.
Thank you.
us join in prayer. Let us pray. With sacred mystery, as we gather in this time of worship, may we bring the best of ourselves. May we bring the deepest of our hurts. May we bring to you our joys and our sorrows. And in response to your love, let us offer our thanksgiving and our talents and our praise. Let us share together in this time of worship and honor your realm in our midst. Amen. We join in an Iona affirmation. With the whole church, with people everywhere,
we affirm God's goodness in the heart of humanity, and in all
that is with all creation.
Good morning. A reading from Mark. Jesus was teaching in the temple, and in his teaching he said, "Beware of the scribes who like to go about in long robes and to have salutations in the marketplaces and the best seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at feasts, who devour widows' houses and for a pretense make long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation." And he sat down opposite the treasury and watched the multitude putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. And a poor widow came and put in 2 copper coins, which made a penny. And he called his disciples to him and said to them, "Truly I say to you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury, for they all contributed out of their abundance. But she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, her whole living." This is part of our story.
I'd like to invite Janet Gray to share with you about Out of the Rain Youth Shelter. Janet?
Thanks. Hello, everybody. I have some notes, but I also wanted to share with you just a couple of small stories about shelter that I hadn't written down. One of them is last week I was speaking at a small neighborhood church in Winnipeg called North Kildonan, where a number of folks knew Megumi and Alan from their Winnipeg days. And at the end of the service, which was all about peace and remembrance, I was asked to speak to a woman named Betty. Betty is probably in her late 80s or early 90s, and she wasn't obviously looking that healthy. But she came up to me and she said, "Oh, thank you. I know you're from the West Coast. I wanted to tell you a story. I don't even know what you can possibly do for me, but I have a son named Alec, and he's out in Vancouver." And I said, "Oh, well, I live in Victoria." And she said, "Well, I don't know if you can help me, but Alec has lived for some 45 years in Vancouver, and he's lived for many, many years on the street. And now he's in shelter, and I know that he's looked after, but I want to make my will, and I want to know how best to direct my money to look after him. And I found out a bit more about the story to discover that Alec had gone out when he was to Vancouver when he was 22, and everything was fine. He'd been with a number of young people that he'd gone out with, and for a couple of years all was well. And then she stopped hearing from him, and she had to look for him and figure out where he was and why wasn't he communicating with her. And sometime later, for a number of years, she thought he had died or something awful had happened to him, and then discovered through a lot of work on her part and some help from people at First United and other people working in services on the street in Vancouver that her son had severe schizophrenia that had happened in that sort of last 25th year of his life, that left him living on the street, and she started sending money to support him and make sure he had shelter. But now she needs to know, as I said, where to direct this money, and because of confidentiality, they will never tell her anything much other than he's looked after. And so it's a story that just broke my heart, and I said that I would do what I can with people that I know through First United and the Longhouse Ministries in Vancouver and others to see if we can figure something out. Then another story is a couple of weeks ago when I was at the Out of the Rain Coalition meeting here at First Met, and we meet the first Wednesday of every month during the Out of the Rain season, to a woman who works with St. John the Divine, Out of the Rain, Karen, said that she had this wonderful story, and it had to do with our other shelter that we're working on here hosting, and that's the adult shelter in the Fellowship Hall. And she came out of church a couple of weeks ago and saw Dawn, somebody she recognized and has worked, been friends with for many years from her work with people, vulnerable people. And she said, "Dawn, how are you doing?" And they exchanged hugs and greetings, and he said, "I'm doing great. I'm feeling wonderful. I had a good sleep last night." And she said, "Oh, what's up, you know?" And he said, "Well, I've got a mat in this church here. And I have had several nights of really good sleep, and it's just making me feel so good, and I eat at our place and other spots, and I just feel like I have so much more energy and more together," because for years, he has been spending an awful lot of every day's energy just to keep warm and dry and keep his stuff, that his few meager belongings, protected, and he was feeling good. So with that, I want to say a couple of reports released by the Greater Victoria Coalition to End Homelessness in 2014 about homeless youth named them as a priority. Quote, "Young people are struggling to make it on their own while trying to get support through oversubscribed social services and programs. Depending on inadequate income resources and attempting to sustain housing in an inexpensive housing market. For youth between the ages of 19 to 24, the picture is dire. Youth previously in foster care age out and are discharged from the child welfare system with little or no supports, and are then expected to make it on their own. There are few services that directly serve this age bracket. They are expected to access adult-oriented services, which many youth we spoke to in this report felt uncomfortable about accessing. The Out of the Rain Youth Shelter is working to reduce the risk faced by homeless youth by providing shelter during the coldest months of the year. It's a coalition of community agencies, faith-based organizations, businesses, and individual volunteers working to provide the physical space, professional support, and food for the operation of the shelter. The shelter rotates amongst host sites in the community in an effort to maximize the community resources to meet the needs of homeless youth. Two trained youth workers staff the shelter each night, in addition to tending to the immediate needs of the youth and lending a friendly ear. These youth workers also aim to empower youth by providing support and referrals to community-based programs. Out of the Rain is volunteers provide the support to shelter staff as a shelter helper or donating hot-cooked meals. Out of the Rain Youth Shelter is from October 15th to April 15th, and it's open from 9 p.m. each night and closes at 8 a.m. in the morning, with 30 spaces for youth and their animals or pets for the age from the ages of 15 to 25. It began in 1997 with a core group of downtown outreachers frustrated at a lack of sheltering services for street youth. And they were determined to find a place for Victoria Street youth to sleep at night. These workers, in collaboration with a group of youth, began asking around downtown Victoria for places willing to open their doors to house the youth. A coalition of communities and faith-based organizations, of which First Met was one, formed, and the Out of the Rain Youth Shelter was born. At their inception, the purpose was simple: to provide a warm, safe place to sleep for homeless youth throughout the coldest months of the year. The doors opened in the winter of 1998 for 6 months, and we have been open every season since. This is the 18th season, and there have been a few changes, the most significant for our First Met community being that we are now using the St. John the Divine Church basement next door instead of our own fellowship hall. By our using St. John's space, we have made room for First Met to welcome the Our Place and First Met project to shelter older adults on a nightly basis. Our shift has gone fairly smoothly, and volunteers at St. John's and their office staff have been extremely generous and welcoming with their support of this move, and we are most grateful. First Met has hosted these shelters by providing a welcome hearty soup, veggies, toast, and hot chocolate each Tuesday evening, and then an equally welcome breakfast of French toast, sometimes sausages, fruit juice, and then fruits, muffins, and a juice box for their backpacks as they leave the shelter on Wednesday mornings. Who makes the soup and who provides the welcome and hospitality? Well, many of you do. Many volunteers, mostly from First Met community, but some are neighbors and friends of our community, and come in and help out. Some 25 people provide the volunteer hosting and fill the roster for the evening and morning shifts, and another 25 or so volunteers make the foods and bring them and provide some of the coordination for this program, of which Penny Bond and Shirley Barty are a couple of them. Volunteers are wonderful, and they make this hospitality doable and provide so much more meaning to the shelter and the youth that it serves than simply providing a space, which is important too. But showing up and showing that we care means a lot. As volunteers, I think we recognize that these youth are like any youth. They could be our own youth, our own children, grandchildren, nieces, or nephews. This shelter does not change the youth's whole life, but does provide a warm, dry shelter and contact with people who care about them as people. Volunteers make the hospitality and food provision possible, but so does the generous donations of money towards this program. And for 18 years, people from First Met have contributed generously to the staffing costs of the trained youth workers and some of the food costs. Thrifty's Foods have also contributed weekly during the season by providing some staple groceries towards the meals, and we hope that donations will continue to come in to support this program. Envelopes at the entrances to the church, if it doesn't say Out of the Rain specifically, you can take them and just write Out of the Rain on them, are a place that you could leave your donations or arrange with the office to do so. I believe that the Out of the Rain shelter is like a seed, and it seeds hope and possibilities in not only the youth, but in all of us who take part in it. And as it says in Matthew 13, verse 32, though it is the smallest of all seeds, yet when it grows, it is the largest of garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds come and perch in its branches. Who are we to know exactly where the seeds that are sown land to grow? Thank you.
And thank you, Janet, and to all, to Penny and Shirley, and all who have risen to see that this program of ministry that has gone on for 18 years continues on, and our thanks to the neighbors at St. John's also for their cooperation and help in that regard. Let's respond with just the first verse of our hymn, I Saw the Rich Ones. Thank you again, Janet. And I know a number will be gathering with Janet for the blanket exercise following our service today. For your thoughts. That phrase was coined, pardon the pun, but that phrase was coined way back in 1522, almost 500 years ago. It first appeared in print by a book by Sir Thomas More called Four Last Things. And yet, while it first appeared in print almost 500 years ago, it could have been in the common usage for who knows how many centuries before then. Maybe all the way back to this story about the widow and her special offering. Because I like to think that it's connected with her, because ever since she did that daring, courageous thing of giving all that she had, it's created all sorts of thought and contemplation amongst people down through the centuries. In those days, the respectable thing to do, the honorable thing to do, was to give a tithe, not 1 or 2 or 5% of one's income, but a full 10% tithe in appreciation to God. And here, this poor widow, who is least able to give, actually ups the ante to a full 100%. Now that's some stewardship approach, wouldn't you say? And it's a story that makes us ponder, what does it mean to give? What does it mean to be generous? Especially when we might wonder, what do I have to offer? So, in this story, we have this incredible gift being offered. And ever since, people have marveled about it. However, when you look at the story in the passage that we have today, it actually is the second half of our scripture reading given in the lectionary. She doesn't show up until the second part. It's a short reading, but the first part of the reading, Jesus is already there in the temple and he's teaching, and it's just days before his own death. And so his teachings must be pretty important here. And he tells people, watch out for those who like to parade around and show how important they are, while meantime they devour the homes of widows. Did you ever notice how that is just right before the story of the widow's offering? There's a connection. Jesus is saying that in a society where people are so greedy that it's those who are on the very margins of the society that suffer out of their greed and their deception, there's something tragically, tragically wrong. Time and again, we keep on hearing Jesus talk about the realm of God. And it's a realm very different than a realm where a widow is left in such a plight. So here is this widow. It's as if she's saying, I know it's not much, God, but it's all that I have. And she's saying, God, a penny for your thoughts, O God. And I wonder, well, in our tradition says that the thoughts of God are embedded in the Scripture. They're not limited to the Scriptures, but they're embedded in the Scripture, is our tradition. And so I wonder, did that poor widow find some solace in passages, well, such as Jeremiah, where God says, before you were formed in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I had set you aside, and I saw a purpose for your life. The thoughts of God, is there anything more important? And when you ponder, what are the thoughts of God about my life and about your life and the lives of others in this world? Aren't those thoughts to be treasured if you were to hear, before you were formed in the womb, God knew you. Before you were born, God saw a purpose for your life. And that's my prayer for each of the youth that come to the Out of the Rain shelters, that somehow they would catch a glimpse of the thoughts of God for them. But no matter what they're struggling with, their life is precious in the sight of their Creator. Is that how you see your life? As precious in the sight of God? Because if that's how God sees us, isn't it about time we saw ourselves that way? A penny for your thoughts, God. God's thought is your life is precious. Handle with that care. I think, too, in this passage, not only what are God's thoughts about this poor widow, but what are God's thoughts about how she has become so destitute in the first place? Do you ever wonder about that? I'm sure God surely wonders. And that's when we hear Jesus' word about a society that's corrupt, a society that is hardest on those who are already most vulnerable. There was a leader of a nation who said, the test for our progress as a society, the test for our progress is not how we can increase the abundance of those who have much, it is whether we can provide enough for those who have little. So this person was saying that the test of are we making any progress as a human race or as a society, as a culture, is not whether we're helping to increase the income of Bill Gates or such folk, but it's have we found a way that we can be just and fair in this society to the littlest and the least? It wasn't a prime minister. I wish I could have said it was a Canadian prime minister who said that line, but it actually was the U.S. president, Franklin D. Roosevelt. And I think those words still haunt us as a society today. I think, too, of a man named Jason Coker, and this is what he says. He says, you know, what's the ultimate goal of a society? If profit is the number one goal, the far-reaching goal of a society, then he says, any generosity is by definition subversive. And so all of a sudden, that sweet widow's offering is much more than just a tribute to faithfulness in the face of adversity. It is subversive in the face of a culture where justice and fairness and compassion are not lived out in practical ways. Did you notice Jesus, how he responded? He didn't give her a meal. That would have been something he could have done. That would have been compassionate. And I'm sure he'd encouraged doing such things, but he didn't do it. He did do two things, though. One was he commended her for it and wanted to make sure that everybody would remember her example. An example that shamed so many others in that day, as it does many today. But the second thing was he spoke as an advocate for people like her when he challenged any system that would devour the homes of the widow, any system that would infringe upon basic human integrity and care. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, the wonderful miracle worker, the great pastor. Yes, all those things, but we will never really appreciate Jesus if we don't understand he also stands in a strong line of Jewish prophets, and that he is very passionate about seeing right relationships in the realm of God being lived out amongst us. And so what does it mean for us here at First Metropolitan? Well, surely it means that we will continue as long as the need is there to be involved in compassionate responses such as Out of the Rain or the Fellowship of the Least Coin or refugee sponsorship and all the rest. But if that's all that we do, we have missed the mark. We have missed our calling, because Jesus, the great prophet, is asking of you and me that we also become advocates for a better world, a fairer world, a world that is known especially by how it cares for those on the margin. The gospel keeps on asking us, will we follow this person, both compassionate pastor and passionate prophet? Let's respond with a continuation of our hymn.
Jesus. Hello, my name's Kathy Cook, and I'm a member of the Refugee Sponsorship Group, which is a group comprised of people from First Metropolitan and our neighbors across the road at St. John the Divine Anglican Church. This refugee sponsorship project has been supported by our community here at First Met in a variety of ways. People have supported them in their prayers for a successful journey here, in the donation of goods to help them set up their household, and also through their financial gifts. We've sponsored a family of two who've come from Afghanistan, a sister and her half-brother, and they've joined their family here in Victoria. They came in mid-September, so they've been here for 2 months now, and I'm very pleased to report that they are settling in quite well, and they are both enrolled in the Intercultural Association English classes, and they are very eager students and are making good progress. Yesterday, I had the opportunity to attend a workshop that was put on by the ICA and the Anglican Diocese of BC to help constituent groups get ready for the private sponsorship of refugees, which is what our congregation is doing now. It was an all-day event, and there were many topics about practical aspects of how to sponsor refugees, which included how to fill out the many, many forms that Immigration Canada requires us to fill out, how to do fundraising, how to set up your budgets. But one thing that really struck me was one person was speaking about the language that we use when we welcome people to Canada and how we describe the people that we are helping. And we often talk about them as our refugees. But actually what happens is once somebody has been approved to come to Canada as an immigrant, the moment they step off the plane, they are permanent residents with all the rights and privileges that come with that. They are free to move anywhere they want in Canada, free to work, and free to enroll their children in schools. So in fact, they are no longer refugees once they are here. And it was pointed out to us that maybe we need to talk about them in a different way and use inclusive language. So from now on, when I talk about this family that we're helping, I'm going to call them the family that we are sponsoring. And the reason I'm up here today is that the knitting ministry of our church has made these beautiful blankets that are in front of us as gifts to welcome our family here. And we are going to present them to them as gifts tomorrow night at a gathering with them and the members of the refugee sponsorship group. So I'm going to invite Tammy forward for the blessing of the blankets.
If I know there are those who have been looking longingly at these nice warm blankets since our furnace isn't working this morning. Someone suggested we could auction them off, but no, they're very special. Anyone who's received any of the gifts from our knitting ministry know that they have been knitted with prayers and God's love, that in the very fabric of what these are, they have reflected what our hopes and dreams and prayers are for those individuals who are receiving these. So with that, I would invite you, we'll do a blessing together, but I would also invite you to come at the end of the service and to just hold this and say your own prayer for those families that have come to be a part of our life here in Victoria. So I hold that invitation open to you with this blessing. For those who receive them, may they know that I am them as warming, comforting, enfolding, and embracing. May these blankets and pillows be a safe haven, a sacred place of security and well-being, sustaining and embracing in good times as well as difficult ones. May the ones who receive these blankets and pillows be cradled in hope, kept in joy, graced with peace, and wrapped in love. Blessed be. Amen.
Friends, with warm blankets to welcome our new neighbors, with nutritious food and shelter for those that we greet through Out of the Rain, through letters that we write for Amnesty International, through involvement in creating better public policy, through all these different ways we make our offering, and we continue with our offering in this worship.
Understanding.
Just to let the congregation know, for those who have been here quite some time, you may know Don and Dean Hodgson. Don, if I could ask you to stand, just to say that they are moving to Winnipeg, and we will miss you both, and for your gift of music, your gift of a wonderful sense of humor, and your kindness. We know you'll be back to visit, but we wanted to just say our blessings go with you.
And it's moving back to Winnipeg. Don and our family go back a long ways. My father was a minister, and they knew each other a few decades ago now, isn't it? So before I was born. It's getting a longer time every year. So journey well and blessings as you reunite with family and friends in that part of our world, that part of our church. We also would share with you the news that Laura Butler is now receiving 24-hour care at home. And so we ask that your prayers continue to be with her. Of course, Laura served this congregation for many years, and we give thanks for her faithful service. And it will be important for her to know at this time that the friendships continue in the days ahead.
May we seek out the Spirit of the living God as we pray together. Let us pray. Creator God, ground of our being, you fill us with awe and wonder as we observe the autumn days unfold before us, the air fresh with the aroma of plowed fields, the trees ready to shed leaves on the waiting ground, the sun sending dappled light over our gardens with flowers, fruit, and vegetables. We fervently say aloud, thank you. Thank you for these, your gifts to us. O Holy One, we are glad to enter your sanctuary this morning, to sing praises to your name and ask your forgiveness for those times we have fallen short of fulfilling your will for us. We desire to renew our relationship with you, O God, and to share ourselves in love with friends and neighbors. Great Spirit, we ask for compassion for those suffering of poverty and homelessness in our own city, and those countries thrust in the midst of violence, disease, and destruction due to earthquakes, hurricanes, or oppression. May we follow your guiding light to befriend and give a healing hand in the best way we can. Come into our hearts, Lord Jesus. Come into our hearts this day. We need your comfort and your love, your strength and your compassion. Mold us and teach us to be healers in our bruised world. May we be your hands and feet as we continue to serve the young people in our Out of the Rain program. Enable us to give of our time and energy when it is needed. We also give thanks for those who give their talents and energies to strengthen the shelter, our place. Our recent news from Paris that around the globe people have reacted in horror and sadness to the slaughter in Paris, and in such dark hours that France declares war under Islamic groups. What can we do, God? Help us as we pray. Guide us as we pray, as we want to attempt to plant seeds of goodness wherever we may be. We want to see heaven and earth renewed in all hearts. Enlighten, we pray, our leaders and nations to become peacemakers and thus help rebuild a broken world. May you comfort and strengthen those sick or in hospital, here in the city, elsewhere, especially in our own congregation, Tom Main and Ivy Rogers, and those you mention now in your hearts. Gracious God, may we always remember and learn from the widow who, in our scripture this morning, who out of her own poverty gave what she could. Blessed Holy Three, hear your children praying. Amen.
Child of God, you are a citizen of the realm of God. Therefore, go forth to walk in a good way upon this earth. And may the waters and winds be a blessing to you, and all the hours of the sun and moon. And may the heart and mind which are in Christ Jesus abide also in each one of us, this day and evermore. Amen.